Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for giving up her afternoon. Thank you, Selma. She only wanted a short bio. Thank you very much for your comments. Yes, it is all Francis Light's fault, and I guess the mystery lies within. It actually confounds me sometimes why we're so interested in unraveling people's pasts. And once somebody's done something that's recognisable and momentous, everybody suddenly wants to know where he was born and what the name of his dog was and all those sort of things. And I often wonder, why? Does it really matter? However, we will kick things off with a bit of a rundown. Now, the idea really for me today with Francis Light is just to give a little bit of a background of his work in the area, what he did in the area, how he came to Penang. I'm not going to talk much about what he did in Penang, just really to try and find out who's the person and how he became the superintendent of Penang. So we start off with the boring stuff, right? When he's born, and he was born in England, he was illegitimate, and his father is reputed to have been William Negus. By the way, I think he was quite lucky that William Negus took him under his wing, and his circumstances would have been a lot poorer had he not, as he was sent to school and looked after. So he had a few more opportunities than the average illegitimate child, I would imagine. So most of the books say he joined the Navy at about 19, but there's a gentleman in Adelaide who's a descendant of the Light family who's done an awful lot of work on this, Noel Purdon. We had hoped that he would have come here, but he's been tied up with something else. Now, he's done an awful lot of research on Francis Light's family, and his evidence is that Light joined the Navy at age about 13. So he then spent the next 9 years or so with the Royal Navy. He met James Scott while they were serving aboard HMS Arrogant, which was, I think, his last ship with the Navy. Scott at the time was 5 or 6 years his junior. 1863, they were all paid off. It was after the 7 Years' Wars and so on, so that means you just get shore leave and you get a minimal amount of pay to keep you going. But it's not enough to live on, and they would have soon spent all their money. So then he headed out east, as a lot of people did in those days, seeking their fortune, as a private trader, which in itself was quite hard in the day, because East India Company ran the whole of India, controlled the trade routes and so on. And if you wanted to come to India, you had to get permission from the East India Company to do so. So a lot of traders, a lot of people did come out and seek their own individual fortune, but quite often by coming out with a ship and jumping ship and putting down some roots and justifying why they should stay there to the company, which generally the company allowed them to do so. So at that time, 1765, he was only aged about 24, 25, and was employed by a mercantile firm in Madras, Jourdain, Sullivan and D'Souza. Now, these guys had been trading the region quite solidly for many years before that. And Light would have been set to work trading out of Madras, all very new to him, all the foreign languages and everything, all very new to him. But after 2 or 3 years, he would have picked up enough local languages, Bahasa or whatever he might have needed to deal with Indonesia or the Malaya area. And he was then sent in 1769 to a base that Jourdain Sullivan D'Souza had in Aceh. They had set it up in 1766 and sent someone out there, and he was an agent for a number of merchants in Madras. So Light obviously showed enough initiative to be sent out to Aceh and be their agent out there, working with a gentleman named Harrop, who was the agent who Jourdain Sullivan had sent out earlier. But sure I'm not missing out all the relevant points here. But at 1771, so he was there about a year, year and a half, something like that, and then the Bugis from Selangor started invading or threatening the Sultan of Kedah, and the Sultan wrote to the East India Company looking for protection. They kind of ignored that, and the Sultan then wrote to Jordan Sullivan and the Sousa. And basically, they sent light, or the Kedah Sultan sent an emissary to Aceh to discuss it with him. Now, this is where some of the rumours of Martina and who was Martina start to creep in, because we're talking 1771. Purportedly, he may have sent a tempting emissary, a woman, to Aceh to convince Light to come over to Kedah and set up a trading post, which Light did. He went to Kedah, but discussions were quite involved. The Sultan wanted protection against the Bugis from Selangor, and that was a complication at the time. And the company would not sort of involve themselves in that sort of thing, and nor would Jordan Sullivan de Sousa. So negotiations broke down a little bit there. Light could sort of see that there wasn't a future in that. But then his friend James Scott, by then, was trading out of Phuket. I'm forgetting to press the button, so I think we've covered those points. So by then, so James Scott seems to have tempted Light to come up to Phuket and begin trading out of there. At the same time, the East India Company got a bit alarmed by the whole activity of a private merchant in Aceh, Jordan Sullivan de Sousa, and sent a mission to Aceh to try and sort of take over the operations and make it a company operation. And at the same time, this whole Kedah request came in, and they also sent a mission to Kedah, and that was the Edward Monckton mission that you read about quite often, which failed through various poor negotiation skills on behalf of Monckton, as it's historically recorded. But Light, in all of this, by now had obviously learnt, you know, Bahasa, which would have been, you know, right around the Indonesian Malay sort of area, useful to him. And he was very diplomatic from those early days. We were still talking about a young guy in his late 20s, probably by then. And he really seems to have managed to endear himself to all these people of high authority. I mean, he, even though he didn't set up that trading post in Kedah, he became really quite respected by the Sultan. And this is something that epitomises Light's life. He becomes a great negotiator and a very diplomatic one at that. So we find him moving up to Kedah. So at this stage, James Scott was about 25, and obviously quite a wily trader, as Light just had a very small ship, and James Scott had a big three-masted ship, so he'd obviously done quite well. He was quite a negotiator and a trader, whereas I think Light was probably too diplomatic and too generous. He's well known for giving away his money and helping people along the way. What are we up to with the slides? So this is where Martina comes in from the will and so on. We know that he cohabited with Martina from 1772. So we're talking about the same period, but you know, is it the emissary that was sent to Aceh and came back to Kedah? Did it happen then? Or did he meet Martina when he went to Phuket? And James Scott's probably saying, oh, there's this really nice girl over here, I'll introduce you, you know. So this sort of tips into the mysterious mix of who is Martina. So basically, Light then traded on his own. So it's when he moved to Phuket that he broke away from Jourdain Sullivan de Souza and became his own trader, which means that he owned his own ship, as small as it might have been. So yes, Sarah was born 1779. Now the interesting thing to me about that is that that's an awful long time, 7 years of cohabitation with no children. So did they have children that died? We don't know. There's no record of anything. There was definitely no named surviving child before that. So, that's an interesting point to think about. And then we have Mary. Again, Noel Purdon's evidence is that Mary was second born. A lot of histories say Anne was the second born, and we really don't know. There were no dates of them, but when we look at their marriage dates and trace it back, the Mary seems to fit coming first and Anne later, born in Penang. Again, once he's in Phuket, Light uses his diplomacy and so on and becomes great friends of the governor of Phuket, his Siamese, who gained all his power from his wife's family. And by all accounts, his wife was quite a fearsome woman to deal with, to come up against, which we'll see in a minute. So the fact that he learned fluent Thai, one wonders if, again, did that come from Martina? Later on, when he's in Penang, he records a census where everybody came from, and he writes Martina Siam. So she obviously speaks Thai very well. He learned a very high level Thai, and there's apparently his little book of where he learned Thai in the Bangkok National Library, and it's a high level Thai, it's not just a market Thai. So he also endeared himself to the Siamese royalty as well. They received him very well, and he made several trips to Bangkok, and the king actually sent ships to meet him and all sorts of things. So a masterful diplomat, no doubt, and still a young guy. Using that diplomacy and charm, he also seemed to have charmed a large number of women in Phuket, many of them sent him letters once he settled in Penang, sort of saying, "I'm heartbroken, I miss you, please send me 10 bolts of cloth or 5 bags of rice or something." So we don't know if that's just his generosity coming out in him or if there's more to it, so I'm not going to speculate on that one. You can do that. Right, so. Yes, I just want to make that point too, that throughout their time in Phuket, Scott and Light were both very keen on getting an EIC base, an East India Company base, over here. Now, why was that? Obviously, a very small number of Europeans lived in Phuket and traded in the region, and there's a lot of wars and warring between neighbouring countries, and even within the country, they never felt quite safe. In Kedah, Light actually wrote to the Bengal government saying that, you know, I really don't feel safe here, and he was advised by people close to him and Kedah people and Sultanate and so on, just not to trust anybody, you know, just to be really careful all the time. So they're very vulnerable, these guys, and I think all along we have to remember that they're both trading on their own account at this point, James Scott and Francis Light, and therefore, you know, the more trade they could get, the better off they'd be. And with an EIC base on this side of the bay, then it would make it much more secure for them. I don't think they were after power or anything like that. Light was offered the governorship of Phuket, but he refused it. But it again shows the high level of respect that he generated in Phuket, from the governor down, really. So in 1783, Light's ship was captured. This was by the French. This was the wars with the French and British are starting to break out. So this adds another level of impetus to East India Company as well, because we've got enemies in the region, and you need to start protecting your trade routes and so on. So Light's ship, the Blake, captured off India and Sri Lanka and so on, but at that time, the French or the British didn't keep their crews and so on captive. They let them go, but they'd keep the ship. So I suspect that from 1783, he wouldn't have had enough money to buy another ship and carry on trading and so on. So strategies may well have changed there. Also, the French attacked Madras in 1782. So that's really stirred up the East India Company to start looking for that base on this side of the bay again. So they dragged out Light's dusty old letters recommending Phuket and Penang, and decided that Phuket was just a bit too sensitive, being in the area of Siam and the Burmese and so on, and not wanting to upset either of them. So they opted for Penang, and this was basically in 1783. So, you know, the wheels are already turning towards looking for a base on this side of the bay. Now Light left Kedah in 1785 and took Martina and the children. Sorry, he left Phuket and took Martina and the children to Kedah, and he headed off to Calcutta. So he was heading over to talk. Or to the East India Company about the settlement on this side of the bay. He had also had an offer from the Sultan of Kedah of Penang. Now, that's obviously when he's come from Phuket to Kedah, and the Sultan's been rattled by the fact that the Burmese are invading Phuket. Even though Lady Chan, we're talking about the governor's wife, the fierce governor's wife, apparently was out there herself fighting and leading the charges against the Burmese, and they managed to defend the island, although a lot of the place was destroyed and burnt down. So there's a lot happening at the time which starts to drive Light this way. He's obviously met with the Sultan, and this Sultan is now the son of the Sultan that he had been dealing with initially. And the son was not the father. And that's another whole story we could talk about for another hour. But basically, that family and the court were really controlling the Sultan, particularly one Chulian merchant. So Light had a lot of diplomatic negotiation to do once again. But at the time, it was offered Penang again in return for defence. You know, they're looking for defence against the Burmese and the Siamese. Sultan actually thought Burma was going to invade Siam and sent men and arms to help. So it's the whole region's in flux at the time. So Light sails off to Calcutta with this offer of Penang again. You've got to think about the negotiation. Who is this guy? The East India Company is a pretty closed shop in a lot of ways. You had to be a covenanted servant and work your way up, and the low servants can't talk to the top ones and tell them what to do. It's just not the done thing. I mean, there's a pecking order to this whole thing. So here we have this country trader sailing over and talking to the Governor General, saying, look, you know, here's an island. Let's do something about it. So it's interesting just that the company is dealing with a private trader and trusting that private trader. They had failed in the past with Monckton and their Aceh expedition, so perhaps they were starting to learn that someone on the spot who understood these people and how they think and how to approach them and negotiate with them may be a better bet. Either way, of course, as we know, I'm getting a wind up 10 minutes, okay. Or is that 10 seconds, David? So, either way, you know, we've been given the island and the go-ahead by the governor to come back and negotiate. Light came back, found that the Dutch had been here making all sorts of promises, and maybe he was really very keen to give him Penang. But again, here comes his negotiating skills. So this guy is now, what, 76, so he's in his 40s now, but very skillful at dealing with everybody and not upsetting either side. And that's again, it just builds and builds his skill in being a diplomat. So he managed to talk him into, as we know, a verbal agreement for Penang, but still wanting that military support. I haven't been keeping up with my little PowerPoint here, have I? So we've been covering off all these points here. And we have William Light being born in Kedah. So this all happened while he was in Calcutta and then coming back to negotiate for Penang. So it's been a light lands in Penang on the 17th of July. And some of you may have seen this picture before, so it's a bit of an old joke for you guys, but this was taken from Light's iPhone 1. But it, unfortunately, it was a prototype and soon afterwards broke down. He sent it off to Apple, but never got it back. It took Apple another 100 years or something to fix it. But in honestly, this is really what he would have faced on the point. The point was very, very wooded and treed, and I think this is a pretty good representation of what Point Penanga would have looked like as he arrived in Penang. And again, I think you've probably all seen this little, this is a detail from the founding ceremony, and really it's the only image that we have of Light, whether it be accurate or not. So a little bit different from his trading days. I'm sure he didn't wear a coat and blue coat and tails and so on when he's trading in the ship. But as an indentured captain in the EIC, which he had to be to have the authority to come to Penang, he's representing the company and the crown at this point. So why was he chosen to superintend the island? It goes back to those points about, well, who else is going to do it? But it's really something special, I think, that the East India Company allowed a private individual who they really knew little about to govern one of their settlements, in effect. They needed that petrol station on the way to China and for all the ships, but they also needed a bit of naval a strategic place for the naval ships to look after the east coast of India during the northeast monsoon. So it's quite a big task to give to somebody who's just been a ship's captain. So again, one can imagine that Light really sold himself very well while he was in Calcutta, something he seems to have had a special knack for. Of course, once you take the island, there's a massive things he has to undertake, the legal aspects, you deal with all the different cultural aspects, and protection of the people, how to deal with land, how to deal with the shipping, how to keep the food stuffs up to the island and so on. So it's a mammoth task for him to undertake at that point. So here we have Anne being born in Penang. It's a little guesstimate, but this is roughly the current thinking on when Anne was born. And Francis Lanoon Light, born in 1790. That was their five children with Martina. In 1891 was another period where Cornwallis really wanted to get rid of the settlement. Cornwallis never supported the settlement of Penang in the first place, and Light was constantly having to persuade them to let him keep going. And he was called to Calcutta at this point, and again managed to sell the idea that he was the man for the job and he could make a go of the island. So, you know, terrific negotiation skills to do that when the company's saying, look, we can't afford to keep you going, we're running at a loss. We want to shut you down. And he's saying, no, give me a chance, give me a chance. And they say, okay. it really, really says something about the men. Of course, this is all the unrest that happened because the treaty wasn't signed with the Sultan. Now that was a real bone of contention for Light. Light never conspired to not pay the Sultan, as some people think. And he was constantly writing letters to the Bengal government saying, we have to come to an arrangement with the Sultan. You know, do the right thing. And so he was constantly pleading. So the last thing he wanted to do would have been to invade the Kedah and put down an uprising, which is what he had to do. The treaty was signed, and that's another great misunderstanding that's been replicated time and time again through the past. The treaty was for 6,000, but in his typical fashion, Light wrote to Bengal saying, okay, it's 6,000, he's agreed to that, but let's give him another 4,000 a year to make it up to 10,000, and we'll call that a good behaviour bond. And the Bengal government agreed. So the treaty was never 6,000, it always ended up being 10, or the amount that he was actually paid was 10,000 a year. And we can see evidence of that in when Leith negotiated for Province Wellesley, and in the wording of that treaty, it says we'll pay 10,000 a year, the same as was paid before. So again, a great example of Light's empathy and wanting to do the right thing by the Sultan. Of course, we've got the war with France popping up here, and Light is building the forts, and he was out on his own again. 5 seconds left now, have I? And again, another example, Light took the initiative to build the fort. He said, I'm not going to write to Bengal, I'll never get an answer, they'll never let me, so I'm just going to do it, and he just sent the bill to London. So he really was someone that, he was a doer. So his death in October 1794 was a bit of a shock at the age of 54. Malaria, it seems to be, got the better of him. And what was his legacy for the island? I mean, I think we can see from where we are now and the lead up to it. I mean, his legacy was his empathy. He encouraged so many people to come to the island. He gave them money from his own account. Running the island cost him more than he was being paid. He was always in debt. James Scott was the merchant running around making all the money, and Light seemed to get a bit of a kickback from that, or he was a part of the company but not involved in the day-to-day running of the company. And that helped him keep going. But if not for that, he couldn't have supported the settlement. So when he goes to Bengal and argues for the retention of Penang, you know, we know it's costing him big dollars, you know, to do that. So you have to respect the guy for insisting on trying to make it work and tipping more and more of his own money into this, to the point where he really didn't have the funds to go back to England. His Fairley & Co. in Calcutta, you know, said, look, you haven't got enough money to buy that farm in England that you'd like to back home. Let's look at it again next year. And of course, he died at that point. So, I mean, his legacy, I think, is the multiculturalism of Penang today. Without his empathy and his understanding of how to deal with people in those early days, it would never have come together and been able to pull it together and manage the legal aspects and everything else. So Martina married John Timmer in 1799. And that'll be another little story. In Quest of Time, we may well show a little bit more about John Timmer, as I've found some new information on him. They had two daughters. And Martina died in 1814. So there's another quest to find where she's buried, but odds are the Catholic cemetery. So again, I just put up this image, and it's in my books and so on. It's a painting which I believe was done around 1796. So we're talking 2 years after Light's death. So if you cast your mind back to that picture Light took from his iPhone, and look at what he achieved in that time, it's quite impressive, really, when he's been left to the sole government of the island. Just before his death, he also wrote to Bengal suggesting a whole new form of government, how to run the island. And they wrote back and said, okay, you now have sole control of the island. You have total control of everything on the island. They empowered him for that. Unfortunately, that was just days before he died. The house. Selma wants to point out, this is the government house where Light built as the official residence. And not very clear on this one, but there is a little bungalow over here, and it may well be Martina's bungalow where she lived with the children, and he probably did as well. If I've got 1 minute, David, I've been granted a minute. I need my eyes. I just want to read a little description that is in this nice little book of Ian Mawson's, A Connection, Phuket, Penang and Adelaide. A little bit hard to get these days. But this was a description of Francis Light, written by a visitor in 1791. Just a short one. And the next morning, while we were at breakfast, Mr. Light, who is the governor, called to give us an invitation to dine with him that day. He is a middle-aged man, plain in his person and dress, but of very gentlemanlike manners. And then after this, they pop over to see Martina in her house. Sunday morning, we went to breakfast at Mr. Light's family house, and saw three of his children, a fine boy of six, who was William, a girl of 3 1/2, who was possibly Anne. We saw the lady after breakfast. She is well made and has been pretty. She had on a green and white striped bodice, laced before, a very full chintz petticoat, buttoned at the wrists with gold buttons. Her hair was combed back and fastened at the top of her head with a silver pin. She could not speak a word of English, interesting, but seemed much pleased with us. So she's obviously taught like Siamese, Thai, but he hasn't taught her English, which is quite an interesting, I guess there's no use for it. They were living in a place where everybody spoke Thai. Mr. Light behaves very well to her and is very fond of his children. I think it a great pity he did not marry when he was a young man. There's another interesting comment. As I dare say, he would have made a good husband. With that, David will be pleased to see you.